My Lord God, I have no idea where I am going. I do not see the road ahead of me. I cannot know for certain where it will end. Nor do I really know myself. And the fact that I think I am following your will does not mean that I am actually doing so. But I do believe that the desire to please you does in fact please you. And I hope that I have that desire in all that I am doing. I hope that I will never do anything apart from that desire. And I know that if I do this, you will lead me by the right road, though I may know nothing about it. Therefore will I trust you, always, though I may seem to be lost and in the shadow of death. I will not fear you, for you are ever with me, and you will never leave me to face my perils alone.
Good evening. I'm Karen Fredette, and with me is my husband, Paul. And we want to welcome you to the second part of our Hermitage Journal series about as I began my 3-month trial of hermit life. We'll be broadcasting over the Doves for Peace channel, thanks to Brother Sean Bradley, and you can find us there each week at this time, or you can find our program on YouTube. Just simply put in Paul and Karen Fredette, and hopefully we shall pop up.
In this series, we'll be offering what we consider to be a rare opportunity. It's the chance to listen to, hear the actual pages of Karen's personal journal, the one that she kept while transitioning from monastic community, the Poor Clare community in Canton, Ohio, to which she belonged for 30 years, into hermit life. And hopefully you'll be able to share into her insights, her struggles, and her discoveries, just as she recorded them in that journal as she experienced them in January of 1989. Karen?
Sharing what I wrote in my personal journal as I began this transition into hermit life is a bit of a risk. After all, it was never intended for anybody's eyes but God's and mine. But over the years, I've learned that what seems to be most personal often ends up being most universal. And when you share what truly happened to you, you hear people saying, well, I felt that also.
Sure.
I went through that. And so by sharing these first months of my hermit life, you may hear an echo of your own experiences or reassurance that what you find happening has happened to other people as well, bumping up into the same questions and doubts and joys that I experienced.
Karen, you were living alone for the first time in your whole life in an isolated little house in Anstead, Virginia, West Virginia, south of Charleston, West Virginia. As we know from last week's account, it was located on Mission Parish property. It was a sparsely furnished and extremely simple little cinder block building. Last week, you gave us a hint of what you were beginning to discover as you explored your surroundings. Could we say a little, go into that a little further this evening?
Well, I'd love to. I will admit that the discovery of a nearby private park road running alongside a stream, which I learned was called Mill Creek, may not seem the most important happening of my stay there, but it contributed a great deal to my joy. After living for 30 years within an enclosure, which confines you to about a 3-acre area, I at last was able to wander freely, discovering new things daily, which was something only God knew how much I needed. I walked along there nearly every day. And here is what I saw and felt about this great surprise. Because originally, I thought that the only walking space I would have would be the parking lot and the highway, neither of which I found particularly appealing. But on the day when I really discovered Mill Creek, I came back and shared it in my journal with the Lord. I said, oh, what joy we've had today, love. The snow is falling steadily, 3 inches now. Temperatures in the high 20s, no wind, so pleasant. I got drawn to try a foolhardy thing and went down the ravine even in the slippery snow and over the creek. Then I got even braver and went around the cliff at the bottom and onto the road. What beauty! It wound up, up, up until I came to a place which apparently had been a community dumping ground. But fortunately, on this day, it was being covered with snow. I could hardly see the water from that height. But what I did notice a little further along was a trestle bridge that covered the gorge that this Mill Creek had dug out through the eons. It intrigued me, but I didn't go to it then. I went back. And later that day, I went down along Mill Creek itself. The road began to lower, and pretty soon I was running along, walking along this great white water, roaring water, laughing water, energetic, joyful water. It was coursing and falling around huge boulders and little waterfalls. On the right-hand side of the road, there was a brick wall, but every once in a while, little streams, little waterfalls would come streaming down and run under the road. And except for that one house, I never saw another human being along that road. And I was so fascinated that I went out again in the afternoon. I said the lighter snowfall enabled me to see more distinctly. And as I pressed further on than I had ever gone, I came to a wide waterfall. It was just fantastic. If you can imagine, the rocks are covered with snow, and this water is streaming down and running around it. I also realized I came across a sign that verified that I was on a state park road with no end in sight. I felt like I could have taken some breathtaking pictures, but I didn't have my camera with me. But will it ever be quite so perfect as it was today? Just picture that.
Mm-hmm. It sounds like you not only were going to take breathtaking pictures, but that you were pretty breathless about the whole thing yourself.
I was.
You've alluded before to the physical enclosure that you experienced in the monastery, and especially more or less the limitation to the 3 acres. And so this must have taken your breath away for the first time in your life to be out roaming around the rocks and the creeks and stuff. But now you are experiencing also the absence of all the other limitations and structures of belonging to the monastery and being part of the sisterhood on a daily basis. Can you say something about that lack of structure or that newfound openness?
I was dealing with a fair amount of guilt, which I didn't want to look too closely at, but I was meditating on it, giving myself the permission to do that, and I came to a rather shocking realization. And I wrote it down this way. I heard the Lord asking, "What are you looking for?" And I thought, and I wrote down, "Healing and wholeness, my Lord, for I feel I am broken and disintegrating and full of darkness." I realized if I'd stayed in the monastery, I could no longer have really helped anyone by that, not given the state of inner division that I was in. I would have ended up by hating everyone and everything. In fact, I think I came dangerously close to that. To realize the truth of this, that I really couldn't stay and be of any assistance or help, has lifted some of the guilt that I accepted when friends and sisters did not see the value of what I was doing. But just knowing that I could no longer help anyone, either now or in the future, I had to get away by myself now. And later, I still pondering on the questions that were bothering me about the monastery. On Epiphany, I wrote this. I see I am very tied up in a lot of guilt complexes, and no longer may I ignore these conflicting feelings within me. Part of my necessary work here is to know and to name what goes on within myself. No matter how ashamed or embarrassed I may feel about exposing such things to the light of just my own awareness.
Mm-hmm.
Only then can I bring them to you for healing and forgiveness. And a little later, I wrote a reflection based on Luke 5:36 to 39. And Paul, would you
sure.
read that for us?
I'd be happy to. It's a selection from Luke that takes place in the narrative at a time when Jesus is invited to the home of Levi. He's taking a meal with a disciple, and at the home are tax collectors and other disreputable people, as well as Pharisees. And at one point in the conversation, it says that Jesus then proposed to them this figure: "No one tears a piece from a new coat to patch an old one. If they do, they will not only tear the new coat, and the piece taken from it will not match the old. Moreover, no one pours new wine into old wineskins. Should they do so, the new wine will burst the old skins. The wine will spill out, and the skins will be lost. New wine should be poured into fresh skins. No one, after drinking old wine, wants new. They say, 'I find the old wine better.'"
I think I was finding some of the old wine from the Desert Fathers. But that gospel image of not sewing new cloth on an old cloak struck me as apropos of something I had been considering quietly, which was to try to live as a part-time hermit and thus more easily remain affiliated with the monastery. But the very thing used to cover the whole, would pull away the new from the old, and the tear would get worse. So to try to patch up the hole that I've experienced in living in community contemplative life with just periods of hermit life won't work. It'll tear away from the old style anyway and just make things worse. Similarly, with the new wine requiring new skins, the new ferment of the spirit in me, drawing me so powerfully to solitude, won't fit the old forms. This new wine, this new joy, must have its own proper expression. And for the first time, I actually said, "Eventually, I'll probably have to sever the natal cord legally to the poor Claire's family. But in truth, what and how I live will always be informed with the spirit of Claire and Francis."
Mm-hmm.
This need to look at my feelings was so important because I hadn't done it. I hadn't allowed myself to do it in the monastery. So I realized as I was looking at my feelings one evening that the dominant one was sadness. And I asked myself, do I really expect to leave a community where I've lived for 30 years without grieving. Actually, it's still too soon for real grief and mourning to even begin or surface. But I want to try letting the feelings surface, any feelings in fact, and at least naming them. All my life, I've denied and suppressed my feelings, joyful or sad, angry or glad. Part of my hermit work will be to become three-dimensional with a depth of emotion I've never allowed. And in part because in the monastery, expressing feelings was verboten, just not permitted. And unfortunately, it fit too well with my
personality.
Yes.
Well, it just sounds like as we look at this first month, that it's just so many mixed emotions. You know, you have this exhilarating new freedom and lack of structure, lack of enclosure, so to speak, after having been enclosed literally for 30 years. But at the same time, it sounds like a lot of conscience things, a lot of guilt wrestling. At the same time, it's kind of affecting the joy and the exhilaration, and the freedom is also being balanced by the guilt and the sadness that you feel at kind of the effect your decision has had on the community. It sounds a little bit, you were reading earlier in the month, last week we talked about it a little bit, and you were reading in 1 John.
Yes.
The first letter of John. And it sounds like, to me, that conscience part is really, I'd like to read that section because it seems to just go at the heart of this. Because it's not unfamiliar for people entering this kind of life at the very beginning to question their motivations and to have all kinds of mixed feelings and to wonder whether or not this is going anywhere or means anything. And, you know, what have I done to those who I've left behind? And so, but in the first letter of John, there's this passage in chapter 3 that says, "This is our way of knowing we are committed to the truth and are at peace before him, no matter what our consciences may charge us with. For God is greater than our hearts, and all is known to God. Beloved, if our consciences have nothing to charge us with, we can be sure that God is with us, and that he and that we will receive at his hands whatever we ask."
That was life-giving to me at that time. The most important line in that text was, "God is greater than our hearts, and all is known to him." I could have gotten lost in what was going on in my heart if I didn't understand that someone was greater even than this turbulent mess, you might say. When you live alone, you begin to know yourself in new and frightening ways. And when things go wrong, there's no one else around to blame.
So it sounds like some of that turbulence that was in Mill Creek that you saw there and were exhilarated by there also reflected the turbulence within yourself. So,
yeah.
You know, there's that inner turbulence and outer turbulence, and you weren't just discovering Mill Creek. You were discovering Karen Carper. And it was as new an experience for you in some ways at that point in your life as discovering Mill Creek.
Very well put. Very well put. Here is something that came up, and I had to face it. And I had feared this. I am beginning to experience some disturbing sense of hollowness. Hollowness in this rich lifestyle of mine. I guess it's not surprising now that I begin to settle into a routine and things lose their novelty. The question arises, is this all there is? And the prayer times seem less rewarding. Now begins the testing of the solitary call. I'm very aware of all the perks to be had here, especially my undisturbed use of time and of finding Mill Creek. But all of this is great, but it's not why I'm here or what can keep me here. Yeshua, you learned the fuller form of your mission and what it would take at your baptism. These months should be a similar learning experience for me if I'm willing to face the frightening questions that shall be arising. Things that I fear will probe the very foundations of all that I think I am and set them toppling. Not a happy prospect. My one consolation is that you won't let me be tried beyond my endurance. I dare not rely, as I am so tempted to do, on my past 30 years of religious life experience, some of which had been very challenging. That won't help me maintain the perspective I need, but I need something new, or it wants to be new if I will let it.
If you will let it, that's the big thing in a lot of these life-changing experiences. I find it a little bit interesting that Karen wrote in her journal, she remarked as she came to a bend in the road that this had obviously been a place where lots of people from the area had dumped their trash. But she not only noted that the trash was being dumped there, but how nicely the snow was covering over all this debris and hiding it from sight to make the beautiful picture. And here she is with this beautiful picture of her new life. And there is a temptation, there is a struggle to cover over what we think of is the trash, all of the uncomfortable things in our own life. And wouldn't it be nice if, just like the snow is covering that external debris, if we could find a way in this experience to just cover over all that other debris that's inside our own hearts that we'd rather not look at because it doesn't look very appealing or very attractive to us. And yet, that's precisely what this life invites us to do. It's the kind of new baptism, so to speak, that eremitic life invites us to. And the temptation is to just go in partway,
It
to
does.
just not dive in over our heads, lest, the rocks, like the ones in Mill Creek, do us in and we never resurface. Some of you may have been with us during our initial presentation on Doves for Peace when we discussed the book that we had written on contemporary hermit life called Consider the Ravens. And at one point, we discussed what the Desert Fathers called the noonday devil, acedia. Acedia being that sense of sadness or that sense of hollowness, that tastelessness that comes in this way of life when we're less than full-hearted, less than complete in our self-gift, in our willingness to immerse ourselves in the solitude and in the silence. Karen talked, I thought it was interesting, you said, you know, the possibility of being like just a part-time hermit. You know, the ability to get away for a while and then, which is understandable, and it's a very normal one in all of our lives, the need to get away, to renew, to become restored, especially when we're feeling run down or burned out or, you know, overly tired, so that when we come back refreshed and we're able to give more of ourselves. And that's a very necessary and understandable reaction and a dynamic that's essential in all of our lives. But eremitical life is a very, very different thing. It's not that we go away so that we can come back later. No. We go away into solitude and silence, and it's not just for a while. It's a complete lifelong immersion. I don't know how many of you have frequent the shore very often, but it always tickled me when I would see people at the shoreline. And, you know, there were a few hardy souls who would actually go on in there and plunge right into the surf and just dive right in under one of these great big waves. But most of the people that were walking along the beach and most of the children that were playing in there, they would just run back and forth and try to escape these waves that were chasing them up the shoreline. Their idea of being at the shore was just to get their ankles wet. They were just deep enough in the sea to get their ankles, or maybe, you know, maybe up to their knees, and some of them actually even maybe up to their waists. But, you know, it tickled me so much because I find that oftentimes in our spiritual life, that's how we respond to God. God is this great wave of love inviting us to become immersed in that. And for most of the time, we prefer to just be ankle deep in God's love. Mm-hmm. It's a lot more controllable and a lot more comfortable. We don't, but it's hardly baptism. Baptism is that sense of being over our heads. And it's that temptation to pull away from being in over your head that strikes at many people who attempt, and not only attempt, but people who do enter into eremitic life, but in those earliest stages and earliest moments, this is one of the more common dynamics and more common temptations and experiences, that of this acedia in to one degree or another.
That's well put. And acedia can drive you out of hermit life if you aren't willing to hang in there. One of the things that we talked about last week was 1 John.
I think for a minute
right.
there we might have lost our
All
place.
Right,
I think you were going to talk about some of those demons that you
right.
yourself were wrestling with specifically.
I apologize for that. Yes, I was also finding my own noonday devils. And I remember marking down, this was towards the end of the month. It's been a tough day. Like the demons were at me with, quote, "It makes no sense for you to be here," or "Think of all the good you could be doing elsewhere," or "Think of those who will be undoubtedly harmed because you're not there," or what kind of future, etc., etc. The toughest of all was the taunt of meaninglessness. Of course, this lifestyle is useless, and it makes no sense, and possibly has very little meaning. But so what, if you're called to it? Like Richard Rohr says so well, we're not here to do anything but what the Lord tells us to do. And that reminded me of a quotation from Thomas Merton, which I had also written down in my journal. And I think he says it better than anyone. He says,
oftentimes he does.
Yes. The hermit, all day and all night, butts his head against a wall of doubt. This is his contemplation, a kind of unknowing of his own self, a kind of doubt that questions the very roots of his existence and for doing what he does. It is this doubt which reduces him finally to silence. And in the silence, which ceases to ask questions, he receives the only certainty that he knows, the presence of God in the midst of uncertainty and nothingness as the only reality of their life.
So, hermit life doesn't make any sense.
It's very hard to justify.
Well, it didn't seem to be easy for you to comprehend in that first month.
But at the same time, I was beginning some important work. Mm-hmm. I was beginning to feel and to allow a growing sense of freedom. I came across the wonderful passage in Luke 4:16-19, which I would
take a look
ask
at.
Paul to share with us.
Oh, and this is the inaugural sermon of Jesus when he returns to his hometown of Nazareth and goes to the synagogue. It says in verse 16, it says, Jesus came to Nazareth where he had been reared, and entering the synagogue on the Sabbath, as he was in the habit of doing, he stood up to do the reading. When the book of the prophet Isaiah was handed him, he unrolled the scroll and found the passage where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Therefore, he has anointed me. He has sent me to bring glad tidings to the poor, to proclaim liberty to captives, recovery of sight to the blind, and release to prisoners, to announce a year of favor from the Lord." A year of favor. The Lord was giving you a year of favor? Or at least the first 3 months.
That just brings me, as I realize it again, it chokes me up just a little bit to realize that Jesus was also saying that to me, that he was bringing me a year of favor. He was telling me to look for liberty and release. The true freedom to which he was calling me. He proclaims to me glad tidings to the poor, and I certainly felt very poor. Liberty for captives, and I was only beginning to realize how very captive I was to many things within me. Sight for the blind. Just beginning to see the light. Release to prisoners. And I've been a prisoner in many ways. A time of favor from the Lord. And as I pondered this, I said, oh, how all this speaks to my deepest neediness, my captivity and powerlessness, my longing for your inexpressible favor and grace, though I also fear the latter because my unworth feels so great and slowly is becoming more clear to me. But I felt encouraged by a poem that John Donne wrote. It's one that you may well be familiar with, Holy Sonnets 5. Batter my heart, three-personed God, for you as yet but knock, breathe, shine, and seek to mend. That I may rise and stand, or throw me, and bend your force to break, blow, burn, and make me new. I, like an usurped town, to another do, labor to admit you, but oh, to no end. Reason, your viceroy in me, me should defend. But is captive and proves weak or untrue. Yet dearly I love you and would be loved fain, but I am betrothed unto your enemy. Divorce me, untie, or break that knot again. Take me to you, imprison me, for I, except you enthrall me, never shall be free, nor ever chaste, except you ravish me.
How powerful, how so powerful that verse is. It just sounds like the month of January for Karen, this first month of this initial trial, was one of a lot of, at least it's striking me as a lot of apparent contradictions, a lot of contradictory feelings vying for your focus and your attention within you, a lot of inner conflict. I don't hear an awful lot of peace. I hear newness and discovery and a kind of a sense of exhilaration at a whole new way of life as an adult, you know, which you had not experienced yet.
No.
This for the first time in your life. So a sense of autonomy, a sense of independence, a sense of, you know, which maybe was just being first formed when you were a teenager, and yet wound up taking a very different shape as an adult for the last 30 years in the monastery. Whereas now it was very unstructured. And so this whole experience, together with the kind of negative assessment that you had about where you were when you left the monastery and the effect of your decision on your sisters in the community, it just seems like all of that is just in a great tumult that's probably well reflected in the winter tumult of Milk Creek that you found so inviting to be with and to contemplate during that month.
Yes, I think that was one of the reasons it fascinated me so much. Mm-hmm. This, the creek was never the same. The water was rising and falling depending on the weather, and that fascinated me. Mm-hmm. You know, it was just finding this differentness every day without going to a different place. But oftentimes, when I was in a lot of turmoil and couldn't really put a finger on it, I'd resort to asking myself, is there an image that would express what I'm feeling now? And I came across, came up with this one. The kingdom, as I've read, is like a seed in the ground, mysteriously sprouting and growing. I am now a seed, buried at last in the rich ground of solitude. My hard shell of a lifetime is just beginning to crack as dormant potentials start to stir and move deep within. I dare to put out some very fine seeking rootlets going down. I begin to feel the need to push upward, gently, relentlessly, against the cracking restraints above me. As a seed, the first rootlets go down, and the seed cracks open, and the tiny little budlet starts to rise, but it has to make its own way through the earth. But it is absorbing nutrients from the very earth it's pushing its way through. And I felt that energy within me to begin pushing, pushing at the shell, cracking it. I wrote that energy is growing. It can be rather nice to be all safely encased and just potential that risks nothing. But I've been that long enough. Something new is pushing out to be realized. I think that is a summary of what was beginning, just beginning.
A very rich time, not a very easy time, but one that at that point you really didn't know where you were going with it. When you pushed against that shell and broke it open, where would you wind up?
What would I wind up
Being,
being?
well, that's.
A seed, does a seed know what it's going to be?
And so, where in this place, where did you find your consolation? What was that, as you looked at that image of that seed, what gave you the.
I was beginning. I came across, and I know the Lord guided me to it, a passage from Hebrews. And I said, wow, if you remember, Abraham is called out, and it says in the book of Hebrews, he went not knowing where he was going. Abraham, when he was called forth, went solely in faith, and moreover, not knowing where he was going. So it is now with me. But I do have the confidence, assurance, the conviction that you are with me. And he had convictions about things he did not see. He sojourned in tents in the promised land, not realizing he was in the promised land. So I'm sojourning in the land of solitude. For my homeland is really only in God's embrace. I no longer can have a secure place in the world. But we have to be willing to dwell wherever you provide through the goodness of others. I knew I couldn't do it. And this section from Hebrews goes on saying, by faith, Sarah received the power to conceive. And that brought me back to the symbol of pregnancy.
Mm-hmm.
That had been one of the first major dreams.
Yes, on your arrival.
On my arrival there. And then Abraham was asked to sacrifice even the promised son.
Mm-hmm.
And to do that with the belief that the promise would still be fulfilled. This is rich. This is the kind of faith I need. I need to spend much time with this kind of faith.
Why don't we stop here for this evening and take a few minutes to reflect prayerfully on what we've been hearing from Karen and these pages from her journal. And then maybe just sum up our prayer for this evening. And again, as always, we invite your comments, your reflections, your suggestions. You can get in touch with us very easily by going to www.ravensbreadministries.com. That's all one word, ravensbreadministries.com. Or you can email us directly at pkfredette@frontier.com. Let's take a few quiet moments and then sum up with prayer for this evening. Lord of wondrous patience, the earth has risen again, emerging from a darkness in a way it has never quite been before, whirling to a fresh time, an unused space. Alive with trembling possibilities, and we with it. Such a staggering grace. Please, nurture us in newness. Set us free from the tyrannies of habit and complaining and blaming. Shake from us the dusty melancholy of too much success and comfort, pride and pretense, that as if on the first day of creation, we may begin to see the miracle of life and humanity. To hear the hum of grace unfolding to meet all our needs, unexpectedly and surprisingly, and urging us to go on in faith to what is next in love.
Thank you for joining us this evening. We appreciate your prayers and we promise you ours. We want to thank Brother Sean Bradley for allowing us to do this. We appreciate knowing what you think of this. You can get in touch with us, as Paul said, and then you can be assured that we are always praying for you too. Let us know what you want from us,